This is not only a feathered friend, it's a rub a dub brand.
Very nice.
Yes, they'll go through a laundry. You may want to write this down. When you're drawing a dinosaur on the back of a t-shirt, it's got to be laundered. Use a rub a dub brand fabric friend. Made by your friends from the Sharpie Company. Someone's laughing at Sharpie. Product placement. When in the field, for soft drinks, we drink Diet Dr. Pepper. It's the only diet drink that tastes like a real drink. It also keeps you regular. And in the field,
that's good to know.
And what else? When you're in Seymour, Baylor County, go to Smokey Bros Barbecue. Tell them I sent you. And they go. In North Central Texas, where I work, there's one question you never get, which is, where did you get your degree? They never ask that. What they ask is, what kind of truck do you drive? Oh, this is going to be a $100 shirt. If I see this on eBay, I'll put you down. But I would again use cold water soda. This is our. We have a Triceratops mummy in my museum, Houston Museum. It shows the skin of Triceratops, and it wasn't naked. It had things growing out of it, bristles. And there are other horned dinosaur specimens that show bristleness. Having watched the World Series, that means Triceratops was a Boston fan. Did you see Poppy hit the home run? The guy's like 60. He's 60. He can't walk, let alone run. He has to hit home runs. He can't make it to first. Poppy Ortiz. Okay, now would you model this? How about that? No, we could do this. Some people arrive at the late. Let's start to Q&A. Let you start at 6 and they're an hour late. And then I'll say, well, that's all the whole book I get bored. Okay, here's the serious question. I've been doing this for, oh gosh, since 1964. How many of you have a favorite prehistoric animal, and it is T-Rex? Be honest.
Hello.
Interesting. Oh, it's Michigan. How many of you have a favorite prehistoric animal? It's Triceratops. More, that's it. Triceratops worldwide comes in second, comes in first for an herbivorous animal. Velociraptor goes up and down with the release of Jurassic Park. A fourth one later on next year, the rumor is, and I think this is false advertising, that it will not have feathers. Velociraptor has feathers. I've seen the specimens. Covered in feathers. T-Rex had feathers. Our Chinese friends have found species of the T-Rex family covered from nose to tail tip with fine kiwi-like feathers. So if you had a baby T-Rex in your lap right now, it would be warm and fuzzy, which is probably bond to you as birds tend to. Oh, I like that response. So Velociraptor, how many of you, knowing what you know now, would choose Velociraptor as your favorite prehistoric animal? So it goes Triceratops, T-Rex, Velociraptor, those are the top three. Stegosaurus, the Colorado State dinosaur, is coming in second among the planters. It's a rare guy. My friends in the Morrison Museum have just found baby Stegosaurus tracks. Little guys, maybe weighing, 40 pounds, 30 pounds less. and they were walking around very near adults, suggesting some sort of parental investment, something like that. So seriously, how many of you are Lutherans in one way? How many of you are Congregationalists?
Why are you laughing at
Congregationalists? You're a Congregationalist? Excellent. The first scientist to prove that what we call dinosaurs are part of the bird family tree was a Congregationalist, the Reverend Edward Hitchcock of Massachusetts, 1836. He was also the first state geologist of Massachusetts, and he gave, he had a parish, and he wrote widely about exegesis. He's a good guy. So write that down. So, is anyone taking notes besides you? She's taking excellent notes. She will have them scanned. Edward Hitchcock, spelled like a gunfire, working from footprints, proved that what we call dinosaurs is really a part of the bird. By the way, a warning, this is an extremely powerful North Texas laser scan. This is so strong we use this to neuter sheep. So if I make a broad sweeping movement.
I want one.
You have annoying male sheep?
Yes, actually I do.
So that's my time.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. My name is Rob Richardson. I'm an instructor here at SC4, and I'd like to welcome you to our inaugural STEM conference. Our goal is to promote interest in science, engineering, technology, and math. And so, as a keynote speaker for tonight, we have Dr. Robert Bakker. He's a world-renowned paleontologist. He received his undergraduate, did his undergraduate work at Yale University, and then a PhD from Harvard. I gather there's some rivalry between those two schools.
Really? I have no idea. They don't ask me about that in North Texas.
He's taught at Johns Hopkins University and also at the University of Colorado and Utah.
No.
Sorry. He's currently the Curator of Paleontology at the Houston Museum of Natural Science. He's working on a PBS documentary series that's due out in 2014. And it's our great honor to have him here with us tonight. Thank you.
All right. Who's in charge of the lights? Can we lower these a little bit? Not a lot. A little bit? Dim them a little bit? Ooh, okay, so you still have enough light to take notes. Excellent. Two quick questions. Who was the first professional paleontologist, the person who was paid to dig up bones carefully and get them into a museum? Who was this person? And at what age did this person begin the professional work? Well, I'll answer that. 12 years old, the first professional paid paleontologist. And what's the name? 1811, way back.
A little girl?
Nobody? There are two books of biographies of this young woman, Mary Anning, A-N-N-I-N-G, Mary Anning. Self-taught, homeschooled, people used to lend her great big thick tomes, which she mastered. By the age of 16, she was correcting the anatomical errors of professors from Heidelberg. They did not appreciate it. However, this is one of her friends from Oxford, Professor Buckland, who invented the Jurassic, really. He supported her big time, as did his friends. In fact, the first best-selling poster of Jurassic life, fossil life, was done by Buckland and his friend Tony Bayer, and the proceeds went to support this 12-year-old girl and her family. And she became so famous that in her 40s, a full-length portrait was painted in oil, which was hung in the Society, the Geological Society of London, the first woman so honored. She began the profession of paleontology. So, although some people still think to be a professional paleontologist, you have to have a beard, or to be a Red Sox infielder, you have to have a beard. If you visit our little museum in Morrison, Colorado, or my big one, we have up to 3 million visitors in Houston, and you want to be a paleontologist, and you're a person of the female persuasion, we will give you a clip on beard. Okay, here's another very serious question. What do the following four people have in common? Number one, Pope Pius the 12th in 1948. Number two, the present Pope, Francis. Okay. The aged but venerable Meacham in the 1930s, a great Protestant theologian. And Billy Graham, right now, the elder statesman, evangelical. I heard him speak in Madison Gardens, Madison Square Garden, way back in the 50s. Anyway, a great a Presbyterian fundamentalist, Meacham, the 1930s, a great evangelist, preacher of this last century, and two popes. Oh, well, let's add a fifth one, the very loud atheist Richard Dawkins. Five people, what do they have in common? They do have some things in common. What? What? Nothing. Drawing a blank here. What, pardon? They're all male, which is interesting, but that's another thing. The two popes and Billy Graham and a great Presbyterian, Meacham, and Richard Dawkins now completely accept the overwhelming evidence that evolution has happened. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting? Wait a minute, we're going to hold the applause. What branch of Christendom has been responsible for the discovery of more T-Rexes than the rest of the world put together? They are in South Dakota. The Larson brothers, and they are Lutherans. I often visit the Dakotas, and it was explained to me by a Lutheran pastor in North Dakota why there is right now a controversy between evolution and creation. He said, well, Bob, it's because we don't understand the original words of the book of Genesis in the language it was written in, which is Norwegian. Anyway, we're starting with a brilliant man who invented the Jurassic, William Buckland. In the 1820s, he did the most important series of experiments in paleontology history. 1820s, he's a young man here. He is holding a fossil hyena. Interesting, a hyena. Okay, here he is, a cartoon by his friend, the young Buckland, in a cave, the Kirkdale Cave. And there were bones in the floor of the cave, bones of lots of different things, including bones of hyenas, adult hyenas, baby hyenas, and bones of horses and elephants and rhinos. And at the time, the most popular theory was these fossils got washed in to that cave by a flood, a great flood, the famous Noah's flood. That was the theory. And Buckland said, maybe not. But Buckland loved hyenas. He had a hyena sent up to him from South Africa. He was going to dissect it. And he looked into its big baby eyes and said, I'm going to call you Billy. And a big mistake, if you want to dissect an animal, is to name it. And he couldn't. Instead, Billy became a pet, lived with the professor, and later on in a very good zoo, and pretty soon was the oldest living hyena in all of England. That's Billy. And Billy taught things to paleontology. In this cave was an extinct hyena, a giant relative to today's spotted hyena, and the teeth were very, very heavily worn. That's a jaw, premolar, canine, cutting tooth. These hyenas have been doing very, very heavy work. They were chewing up, among other things, rhinos. Rhinos used to go across England. Actually, used to go across Michigan. North America had many rhinos. Anyway, hyenas were found with chewed up rhino bones. And Buckland had a thought, an experimental thought. He said, maybe these bones weren't mushed in. Maybe these bones were brought in by hyenas who were chewing them up. So he did an experiment. Remember, he had Billy, had hyena. And he had bones. He had bones of oxen, big animals. So he fed the bones of oxen to Billy and collected them afterwards and see how a hyena would bite bones. And he compared them to the bones, the fossil bones in the hyena cage. They matched perfectly. The fossil bones chewed up in this cave matched perfectly what Billy had done. Isn't that a brilliant experiment? That's the first piece of experimental vertebrate paleontology. Way cool. Okay, and then he needed another piece of evidence. He had evidence from here, what the hyena did with its jaws, and he needed other elementary evidence from the other end of the hyena, this end. Inside this cave were found lumps of rather whitish, smooth stuff, no smell, whatever. And they looked a little like alba greca, which is a name for a substance that you could make way back then, bone china, which was all the rage in England, bone china. So what he needed was evidence of how a hyena would process a rhino if it chewed it up, or an ox. And inside this cave, these lumps of white stuff were calcium phosphate, had to test for. So he did another experiment. Okay, here's the stuff that's calcium phosphate, the same material of bone. And he did the first caprological experiment. That is an experiment on fossil poo. And we at the Houston Museum have a brilliant man who's our crapologist. He is responsible for thousands and thousands of pieces of poo. Anyway, this is Karen Chin, University of Colorado, who's the reigning queen of everything excrementary. Okay, so they fed Billy the hyena, the pet, the big bandy eyes, lots of bones. And then he told, Professor Buckland told his relatives and his students, when Billy punches over to poop, tell me. You need to see it, tell me. So he went on to his chores of teaching, and finally the messenger said, it's happening. And all the guys in their academic robes rushed to Billy's cage, and he was bent over, and out came this beautiful lump of white stuff, almost odor-free, warm, soft. And the dons, the professors, just held it and said, wow, that second experiment, except for being gooey, it matches the fossil stuff we found in the cave. It was fabulous. So anyway, Professor Buckland published a paper about the Kirktail Cave, and the evidence is overwhelming. It holds up to today. Those bones were not washed into the cave. That was a hyena lair. The hyenas were dragging in prey, dead or dying, chewing them up, living right there, and pooping. And it changed the whole notion of the English hyena. It was no longer a craven, smelly scavenger. It was a noble predator, leaving a noble record behind. And this is my interpretation of Buckland's description of the last English hyena upholding English family values on a hill surrounded by those socialist Frenchmen. Anyway, brilliant guy, an experimentalist. He tested ideas of how fossils formed and what information the fossils could give. Okay, I'm a Bucklandian. I wanted to experiment, if necessary, with poo and with other forms of animal behavior to try to figure out how fossils got formed. This part of our work in the Jurassic, late Jurassic, of Wyoming, that's a baby predator tooth. That's an allosaur, probably 6 months old, maybe 30, 40 pounds, right? We find a lot of those. Here is a potential prey animal. That's a camarasaur tooth. Now look at these two. Which one is the danger to the other? That's a little predator, and here's a tooth of a plant eater with one bite could pulverize, make into haggis, Jurassic haggis, the predator. There's the predator, and there's the herbivore. By the way, herbivores are very dangerous. The most dangerous animal in Africa today is not the lion. It is the hippo. Hippos can bite lions in half, and they do. Hippos can bite crocodiles in half, and they do. Hippos attempted to bite in half Jacques Cousteau with very expensive camera equipment. If it bit the camera equipment, they missed Jacques. Plant eaters, vegesaurs, are not LSTs, large, slow targets. They bite back. And an adult camarasaur could easily crush in one bite a baby allosaur. And yet we do find them together, which is puzzling. This seems unlikely. Here is your very ambitious baby allosaur and an adult camarasaur. And even if it could subdue the camarasaur, if it starts eating here, by the time it gets to the neck, this guy will be in college. And yet we find teeth, shed teeth. Dinosaurs shed their teeth like crocs and sharks. They grow new ones and shed the crown. So we find shed teeth of baby allosaurs with the chewed up bones of gigantic plant eaters. 1,000 times heavier. 1,000 times heavier. That's like coming home to your cat, your domestic cat, and dropping off a complete Hereford. It's that disparity. Pussycat and Hereford. Now let's think about this changing tooth crowns. You don't do it, mammals don't do it, but most other animals do. This is a T-Rex looking in the inside of the jaw. The jawbone has been pulled off. Here's some teeth. That is the crown there. That's the business end. Held in by a long root. But look, here's a new crown growing up. This is an adult T-Rex, but not a baby. A new crown is growing up, and had this animal lasted another couple months, that crown would have pushed out. The pressure of this crown would have dissolved the root, and out the crown would have fallen. We call these dinosaur bullets. They show you where an animal was feeding. That's pretty cool. This is an allosaur, an X-ray, and it shows the new crowns growing in to the tooth socket. Here are the functional crowns. So they never, ever run out of tooth crowns. If you're bitten by a crocodile or an alligator, and I've been bitten by both, or a monitor lizard, and I've been bitten by one, if they hold on for a while, usually they'll leave a tooth crown or two in your skin. They're not damaged at all. A new crown will grow in. You may be damaged. The animal isn't. So these things can be dug out carefully, and they tell you something about who was biting whom. It's a little like an old-fashioned tubular magazine. Now, this is not North Texas, so I don't expect half the men to identify the model rifle here. Notice the blunt nose there, the long cartridge case that's brass. That is not copper jacketed. The reason you can have a tubular magazine is the bullet, the thing that's going to fly out. It's not really sharp in the front. Do any of you men recognize this particular firearm? Pardon? If you go far enough back, yes, this is in fact a German tubular magazine rifle from about 1880. But everyone, the early repeating rifles, including the Spencer and Henry's, had a tubular magazine. And it's like the tooth socket of a dinosaur. A bullet is fired, then a new one moves in, and it's fired, and a new one is moved in. So much for ballistics. You guys are not as excited as Texas, and that's important. Here is from an alligator. That's a new tooth that was growing in that hole. And that's the tooth root there, and eventually that tooth will grow up and dissolve the root and will fall out. And if you dig carefully and dig with us, we're talking about some joint expeditions between your illustrious place and us in North Texas, you'll find such things. Here's a whole bunch of Jurassic crocodile teeth, big ones, big adult males, and little baby ones. All right, now let's get into sociology of fossils. Can we actually tell something about the family values of dinosaurs? Oh, we just found out something about hyenas, that they live together, they chew together, they poop together, you know? The family that poops together stays together, Grandma used to say. Yeah? You had Grandma said that? Okay, here are baby crocodiles today. They are never found with dad. Mom, yes, dad, boo. And the brood of baby crocodiles is large, and there's only one mom per 30, 40, 50, or 60 babies. So if the fossil record is faithful in telling us something about family values, we should find out something like this. This is the standard sociology of crocodiles. There's mom with one of, let's say, 60 babies. Dad is not in the family, doesn't live in the same place, tends to be out in the deeper part of the river, working on his car, drinking beer with the guys. Actually, what they do mostly is fight each other. Again, it's a lot like North Texas. Anyway, if the fossil record is faithful, it should give us mom-sized teeth and lots and lots and lots and lots of baby teeth, but no dad teeth. The fossil record is that good. You know, it is. We spent several years digging in Wyoming. That's a graph of the number of teeth, the teeth shed, and the size of the teeth. We got zillions and zillions and zillions of baby teeth. And a few of them might be mom-sized, and none up here. No big bulls. So there's mom feeding out a fish in part of her huge brood. That's an ancestor of us, by the way, a little furball. So the fossil record is good. You can reconstruct the dynamics of crocodile families from their shed teeth. That's pretty cool. All right, let's get back to that problem of predators that are too small. Here's this guy, this tiny, tiny, tiny 4-pound baby allosaur. As an adult, it would have a tooth that size. It would be about 2 tons live weight. Here's an answer. When we collected carefully, we found the baby teeth, baby allosaur shed teeth, with the chewed up bodies of very big prey, no small prey. The babies were not out chasing bugs. They were eating steak, you know, 40,000 pounds of steak. Wherever we had lots of baby teeth, we had half-grown teeth and fully adult teeth, always. We never found the baby teeth by themselves. And always, there were a lot of giant-sized teeth, the size of adult females and adult males. Unlike crocs, if you're an allosaur and you hatch out of the egg, you're surrounded by a full-grown adult who is protecting you and giving you food. Well, that's kind of cool. So here is our very expensively produced, your tax money was involved here, computer-generated, highly accurate, a reconstruction of the family dynamics of an allosaur in the Jurassic of Wyoming. Here are the kids, and imagine there's 60 of those. And here's dad, you know, and he's right with the kids. He's feeding in the same spot. The same spot. That's like way cool. So how did the baby allosaurs get giant prey? Mom and dad, or adults working together, were capable of killing a big animal and capable of dragging it around. Predators drag food to their lair. Crocodiles do that. Of course, lions are famous for doing that. So it is quite probable that something like this happened in the Jurassic. Mom and Bob, or two sisters, dragging a huge kill home. And imagine you're a baby allosaur. There you are. Just hatch out of egg. Here's your first meal. Brought to you by mom, or maybe dad, or Uncle Hank. There you are. Nobody does that today. Nobody who's a cold-blooded reptile does that today. Crocs are pretty good parents, but they don't do this. Crocs do protect, the female will protect her eggs, but not for the whole life of the animal. The only evidence we have of meat-eating dinosaurs is that they had a society that was like a bird, like an eagle. Imagine allosaurus and T-Rex being like giant groundhogs, not like lizards. All right, here's another cute thing we can do with shed teeth. The most famous predators I've worked on are raptors, and they fed upon an animal like this, which looks a little like a duck-billed dinosaur, early Cretaceous from Wyoming and Montana. An animal called Tenontosaurus, there it is. There's the predator, Deinonychus, and we do find shed teeth of the raptor embedded in the skeletons of the plant eater. Not just once or twice, but we have 66 of them from 12 different specimens. So the traditional view in this case is absolutely correct, but there's a wrinkle. There's a wrinkle. Here's a tooth, much enlarged, of Deinonychus, which is called Velociraptor Anteropus in the first book called Jurassic Park, where I'm cited a bunch of times. And in the first movie, there's this annoying kid called Billy. Remember Billy? Yes. Dino geek. We all of us who geek dinosaurs are afflicted by stalkers called Billy. Billy Aspen. At one point, to humiliate the paleontologist star in Jurassic Park, Billy says, and I quote, "Bakker's book is thicker than yours." That's because at that point, Jack Horner, my colleague, had published a very nice but thin book. And I published a pretty nice thick book. That didn't help my relationship with Jack. Anyway. Here is a shed Deinonychus tooth. That's really about this big, you know, about as thick as the end of your thumb. It's really sharp with a saw edge back here, much finer saw edge, and there, the chewing bone. So this is a raptor, and the tooth was embedded in the body of its victim. And who was the victim? Another raptor. So again, your tax money was used to generate this highly accurate, highly precise illustration of what sometimes happens with raptors. That is, raptors were attacked and killed, or at least chewed by other raptors. This was a bit of a shock to those of my friends who didn't realize that cannibalism is not an odd thing in nature. It's almost the rule. In Isle Royale, way back in the late 70s, I was an undergraduate at Yale, and some guys across the road were studying. In Isle Royale, there was a dominant wolf, the alpha wolf. He was seen from helicopters, dominant wolf. And there was a beta wolf, the next in command, who was very sort of subservient. And then one day, from the helicopter, the wildlife manager saw that the dominant wolf was limping. He injured his leg. Oh, that's interesting. The next day, they found the dominant alpha wolf as a chewed-up skeleton. His brothers and mates had eaten him because they noticed he was limping. And cannibalism is just a form of intelligent recycling. If you see a relative who is limping in some way, not productive in some way, you know, you've got mouths to feed, there's the rest of the pack, and he's meat, and you don't want it to go to waste. So you eat Uncle Hank or Aunt Celia. And it happens with lions, and it happened with people, it happened with the Anasazi people in New Mexico, it happened all over the world. Don't bury them, recycle them. All right. Now the single most important story, in my opinion, about CSI using Buckland's approach to bringing animals back. Here we have Allosaurus again, the most common, late Jurassic. This is a skeleton in New York, beautiful. This, by the way, there was only one dinosaur that was rustled. Actually stolen by one group of diggers from another group of diggers. This animal was practically unknown in the great dinosaur rush of the 1870s and 80s. People find bits and pieces of the Allosaur, but not an entire one. If you wanted to make your name in paleontology in the 1870s and 80s and 90s, you would find a complete meat eater. Meat eaters are not as common as plant eaters. They're one-tenth as common. Professor Marsh of Yale, Hula Hula, had his people out there looking for old Jurassic dinosaurs and especially meat eaters, especially meat eaters. All he had was a hip, some bits of tail, a little bit of front jaw, not a lot. Professor Cope, the rival from Philadelphia, actually hired dinosaur rustlers, the Hubble brothers. It is alleged they were from Minnesota. I would infer they're Lutheran, but that's just the romantic in me. Anyway, the Hubble brothers, first names unknown, went to Como Bluff in Wyoming, and they watched when the field party from Yale would move. They waited for the field party to move from the west to the east. Then the rustlers went to the west, and they saw some bones sticking out of the rock, and they dug like heck, and they found a complete Allosaurus. And they packaged it up, took it down to the center of the valley, put it on the Union Pacific Railroad, and it went to Philadelphia, where it arrived in 1880. And Professor Cope had scored a huge coup, the first complete skeleton, or nearly complete, of a Jurassic meat eater, a big one. Wonderful. Problem. Cope never opened the crates. Why? There was no packing list. There was nothing. And these guys, the Hubble brothers, had sent some packages before from the Jurassic. And when Cope opened them up in Philadelphia, they were junk. They were fit for being paperweights or for doorstops. You know, they were junk. So when this last crate arrived, and there was no packing list. It did not say, open immediately, complete Jurassic dinosaur skeleton, very important. Did not say that. It just said, Hubble Brothers, Como Bluff Station, Wyoming. That was it. So it didn't get open. And Cope started getting old, and he was suffering from some unspecified disease, and he was broke. He spent all of his money digging fossils. And he sold his collection of fossils to the New York Museum. They were glad to have it, lots of important stuff. But there was this big crate, which had no packing list and no label, and it just sat there in New York. No one opened it. Why should they open it? That's so many other things. Finally, it was the very last crate, 1907. And he said, let's open it. Did the crowbars. They were aghast. They looked in. Here was this beautiful, glassy, black bone, and it was this complete Allosaurus, the best ever found. They were so excited, they had an article written about it. It was on the cover of Scientific American. If you look it up, go to an old library. And they mounted the skeleton in this beautiful pose, feeding on a brontosaur skeleton. They had dug from Wyoming, from the same level, a brontosaur skeleton that had tooth marks in the tail. Great big gouges had been cut out of it. And the teeth in this rustled allosaur matched the bone bites. Way cool. They had the perk, they had the pick. And this today is still the most dramatic Jurassic tableau ever done. It's beautiful. It is possible this individual allosaur did the damage to that individual brontosaur. At the very least, they lived within smelling distance of each other. It was way cool. Okay, Stegosaurus, Colorado State dinosaur. In the movie Fantasia, the first one, Stegosaurus takes a fall. It's fighting with the big meteor, and there's lightning and whatnot. And most of the fight, the Stegosaurus is winning. It's swatting the allosaur in the mouth with its tail, and then suddenly the Stegosaurus just takes a dive, just falls down, and dies. I suspect mob money from Jersey. Because the Stegosaurus, look at it. It's a very good movie. Look at that. It's winning, and that falls down. There is this idea perpetuated that top carnivores like T-Rex and Allosaurus are killing machines like a white shark. Unstoppable killing machines. That is bosh. If white sharks were unstoppable killing machines, there'd be no tuna left in any ocean anywhere. They're very unstoppable. Anyway, the idea of the Stegosaurus being a milch cow from the late Jurassic, totally innocuous and an easy mark, is wrong. I'm going to prove that to you now. I'm going to try a Stegosaurus, Stegosauri in general. I'm going to try them for assault with attempt to commit murder and with murder. You're the jury, and I'm the prosecuting attorney, which was my goal in life in the fourth grade. But instead, I became a paleontologist. Okay, here's Stegosaurus, which is not huge. It's maybe 5, 6, 7 tons, not gigantic. It's unusual to have an extremely flexible body. There are no stiffening rods. Most plant-eating dinosaurs have rods of bone, and the backbone here and here, make the whole backbone really stiff. Stegosaurus is not like that. It's very flexible. Short but very muscular front legs, and those four spiky things back here, known to people who read Gary Larson as thagmizers, in honor of Thad Stevens. But that's another thing. Okay. And here's an allosaur, and we've got to talk about this bone here. The biggest, heaviest bone in a meat-eating dinosaur is this, the lower front hip bone. All of the other bones in the skeleton are hollow. This is solid, solid bone. Heavy. You gotta ask yourself why. T-Rex, same thing. This bone is very heavy. Why would that be? Bone is expensive to make. You don't want to have extra. Professor Marsh called it the sits bone because you could sit on it. Makes a built-in camp stool, and this is good because it gets your body off the ground a little bit so you can rest and look around, sniff the air, and if you had to get up and run away or run at something, it's much easier to get up from this position than if you're flat on the ground, the sits bone. Okay. There's another way to use this bone. Many animals, particularly big ones, jump on each other during social interactions to establish who's the highest in the social hierarchy. They can do that. The This, by the way, is one of the first pictures ever done of meat-eating dinosaurs, done for the New Jersey dinosaur, Nidops, found in the 1860s and 70s. And here's one about to jump on the other. And do they want to eat each other? No. It's just two guys trying to establish who's number one in the New Jersey society. You will understand this on episode 7 of The Sopranos on HBO. By the way, I grew up just where The Sopranos was filmed, and they have a private school where The Sopranos sent their kids. I know where that private school is, and the body of the Polish sausage maker that they buried in the riverbank, I know where that is. It's a glorious moment in Jersey. Anyway, Jersey produced the first good skeleton of a Cretaceous meat eater, a Nidops. All right. Now, this is a thing you can do if you have a heavy solid bone here. You can go up, and you can go down, and you can make your point. Kaboom. This happens all the time. In today, we see cows, longhorns and Herefords and Angus, doing this. They're mounting each other, and it's about who can make the heaviest, weightiest point. Now, I'm number one, I'm jumping on your back, and see, I'm number one. So it's quite probable that the sitz bone was also the club bone in this type of interaction. So here is a very early meat eater from the Middle Jurassic, Megalosaurus. Maybe a fan of Megalosaurus. And notice it has three fingers, it's not T-Rex, and a smooth head, no horns, that's a Megalosaurus. And that has a short but massive sitz bone that's not hollow. It's a weapon, it's a club. So the sitz bone, the one bone, the whole body that's least vulnerable to damage is the sitz bone or the club. But, and this is a little gruesome, here is the bottom of the sitz bone in an allosaur we dug up. And it's got a hole in it. It's been shot. That hole is about big enough for a 20-millimeter anti-tank round or a giant elephant gun. And it goes right through the sitz bone from underneath. It's the scariest wound I've ever seen. That's from the inside. Here's the entry wound. And all of this is bone eroded out by infection. Didn't die right away. It was an excruciating pain for weeks. And it was dripping green malodorous pus. That was a garage band I was in. Malodorous pus. But that's another whole story. There's so many other stories. But anyway, green malodorous pus was dripping out the rear end, butt end, which probably made the entire animal not only in great pain, but quite stinky. Okay. This is an interview. This is all eroded bone, bacterial erosion. Here is a latex cast of the inside of the wound. That's the entrance wound, nice clean cylinder. Actually, it's tapered. It's like the entry wound was pointed. And this is the abscess. This is really bad. This is bad. The infection spread all through the sitz bone and through the body and killed the animal. Killed it. So there's a perp out there in the Jurassic who did this near fatal damage. Of course, we pointed the finger at Stegosaurus, because Stegosaurus has pointy things. Its tail. Couldn't this pointy thing have made that wound? Well, no. It looked like you could get, if you were a lawyer, a defense lawyer, Jurassic Johnny Cochran, you could get the case dismissed because the spikes in Stegosaurus face sort of sideways, and you'd have to tilt your allosaur back like a chorus girl kicking at the follies to get this bone exposed, and this is an odd scenario, you know, some sort of flash dance meets Jurassic. No. The direction of the entry wound is wrong, and I've been watching Law and Order forever, and I know that this type of evidence would get it's the wrong direction. Just move it. You'd have to tilt this animal up to get a wound coming from underneath. A wound from a Stegosaurus would be horizontal. The wound in our allosaur is vertical. Here it is. Here's our allosaur, and you got to get the wound coming up from the ground. So we need an alternative scenario, and we have one. We can generate a believable alternative theory of the crime somebody shot the Allosaur directly from underneath, or nearly directly. So here it is. Our Allosaur doing its thing, and suddenly it is ambushed from directly underneath by a pointed bullet. Those weren't invented until the 1890s with Mausers. Pointy bullet. And there's our bird. That's a Mauser repeating bolt action with a scope. I didn't need a scope, but it's 10 feet away, I don't know. And the spiked helmet of a German officer and pouches there, and boom. Makes perfect sense. Not really. We've got to reconsider the weapons that Stegosaurus carried, the Phagmiser. This is the end of the tail of a Stegosaur. The spikes. And these little things here, they're called Z-joints, zygapophyses. These things going down from the bottom are called chevrons. They're both attached to muscles in life, and they both control the movement of the tail. This is not your standard dinosaur tail tip, or crocodile. This is the type of tail that animals have today that can control the very tip of the tail. They can move it around. Who has a tail like that today? Well, here's one. A long tail, and it's got zygapophyses and the chevrons. It can do this. There are animals alive today that can curl their tails. They're monkeys. It's a woolly monkey, which, as we discussed, has that thing that female spotted hyenas do. And if this were a NC-17, I could explain that. But anyway, if you want to curl your tail, you've got to have those extra joint and muscle prongs right to the end. And prehensile animals have that. So, what did Stegosaurus do with its incredibly strong prehensile tail? It probably could do this if you had a forklift and could lift it up into the tree. And then it could cause confusion in baby Allosaurus. Although the tensile strength of conifer wood, the main problem is how to get the Stegosaurus up in the tree. We haven't solved it. If you look at the vertebra, and you're looking at them, the front of each vertebra, here's the first one behind the hip, the third, the sixth, the 12th, 34th. You can actually twist the Stegosaur tail a lot more than the average dinosaur. It's got the joints, it's got the muscle, it can twist. Yeah, can do this. And crawl around. It's quite cool. There's something else about Stegosaurus. How many of you work out? Those of you who say you work out, will you now point to your deltoid muscle? Please point to your deltoid muscle. If you're working out, you know where it is. Deltoid. It comes to the top of your arm here on the outside. Deltoid, right? Am I right? When you do this, you're using your deltoid, right? If you get on all fours, you're running around on all fours, and you want to turn, you're using your deltoid. It pushes you, right? It's the deltoid. It'll be attacked. This is the front of a Stegosaurus, and there are several muscles. Besides the deltoid, that pull the arm sideways, there's the supracoracoid and the deltoid. They come on the outside of the shoulder and attach to the outside of the upper arm. And there's a muscle that pulls it inward. Outward, deltoid. Inward, coracobrachialis. Do it with me, everyone. Outward, deltoid. Inward, coracoid. Outward deltoid. This is amusing to me. Supracoracoid. There are other muscles that do this. Your pectoralis does that. This is called adduction. Moving the arm inwards, this is called abduction. Outward. I used to teach human anatomy at Johns Hopkins to pre-meds. Actually, they were pretty good. Except for the guys who wanted to be surgeons. All of the guys who wanted to be surgeons wanted to be heart surgeons, and they cheated. Every last time I threw one out of school. They cheated. And we had a saying, it's translated from Hebrew, my grandma said it. It was a question, what is the difference between a heart surgeon and God? God doesn't think he's a heart surgeon. But anyway, the students I had who were pre-vet were great. The best were pre-pediatricians. They're now practicing pediatricians. They were my best students. So if you have an injury somewhere in Texas, go to the vet. If you can't find a veterinarian, go to a pediatrician. Anyway, so the coracobrachialis pulls it in, the supracoracoid delta pulls it out. That's interesting. These are huge muscles in Stegosaurus and Brontosaurus too, two groups of dinosaurs. There's the deltoid, and it's gigantic in some plant eaters, including Stegosaurus, gigantic. So what Stegosaurus could do, pulls with the deltoid on the right side, it's moving to the left, or vice versa. That is the deltoid muscle of a Stegosaurus. It's ginormous, it's huge. 4 times bigger than Triceratops. Why would you need a turning muscle? Because of this. Remember, the body is really flexible. Stegosaurus has the most flexible vertebral column of any dinosaur family. By none. By comparison, T-Rex is stiff. By comparison, Triceratops is incredibly stiff. Duckbills are stiff. Stegosaurus is designed for very active, three-dimensional choreography. It can do that. So, if you look at a Stegosaurus, don't imagine it as a stiff, easy-to-kill target. You know it, true? Stegosaurus is all three musketeers and D'Artagnan together. It has 4 swords in its hand. Where do the 4 swords come from? It's got 4 spikes. That's the bone core. In life, the bone core would have been covered with a long sheath of connective tissue. So here is our very dangerous sword-finding, very flexible T-Rex. It could do this, piece of cake. It could twist the tail around and direct at least one of the spikes straight up into the sit bone. It could do it, absolutely. And we're convinced that it did do it. We actually had a group like this, 3 of them. We had 3 juries, or grand juries, in Houston. And I presented the evidence, and they all voted to indict Stegosaurus for killing, for assaulting, wounding, and killing the allosaur. How many times did this happen? I don't know, but probably often. I know of one other specimen with bad damage from a Stegosaur. Now, what happened when the allosaur, let's say it's a dominant male, I'm not sure about that. The male comes back home, and there's the matriarch. By the way, it appears, the evidence we have, it appears that among meat-eating dinosaurs, it's the female who was dominant. The biggest T-Rex specimens are female. There are suggestions the same is true with Allosaurus. If that's true, then they were probably a mated pair. In eagles and hawks, that's also true. The female eagle is the bigger one, it's the matriarch. And in our favorite animal of the biology department and the archaeology department of this wonderful college, the fighting skipper, right? They're named for a wonderful fish in Indonesia, the mud skipper. I'll send you a picture. The favorite animal we had at lunchtime, talk about that. Our spirit guide as an animal is the female spotted hyena. The most social, most advanced, arguably the smartest predator today. And she's bigger than the male. Okay, so here she is waiting for dad to come home. And there's one of the kids, and there's dad. He's not dead, but he's really hurting. And he lasted for weeks with that infection. And it looks like somebody was taking care of him, although ultimately the care failed. So the parting word is, kids, don't eat your father yet. He's had a bad day. However, we have evidence that he did finally pass his reward, and they did eat him. We find adult teeth and baby teeth around dead dad. He had been chewed, and not as badly as other specimens at the lair, but he had been chewed. Okay. Now, I mentioned that Brontosaurus, the long-necked dinosaurs, also had great deltoids, and they really did. Here's a Stegosaur, a shoulder blade from the outside. This is the front edge, and all of the red is the deltoid. It's much bigger. The bulge here is much bigger than a Triceratops. Stegosaurus has that big bulge there, but it's not the only one. It's not the only dinosaur with a dangerous move. This is Brontosaurus, and that's the deltoid, which is gigantic. And right with a long-necked plant eater, here are two more of these long-necked plant eaters. Here is Camarasaurus and Apatosaurus. See this great bulge? That's a deltoid bulge. That's a turning muscle bulge. Why would these long-necks have it? Again, we look at the tail weapon. They have very short bodies, very short torsos, and something that looks like a whip way in the back. And if you look closely at the tail, the bones get simpler and simpler and simpler. And the last 30 or 40 bones are simple rods. A regular tail is pretty complicated. It has these Z joints and a hole for the main spinal cord and a hole for a main artery and this thing down here for muscle. Stegosaurus keeps that complicated design to the very tip. And not the long necks, not like Brontosaurus. Brontosaurus, the tailbones get simpler and simpler and simpler. Now they're just rods. And look, you've heard of ball and socket joints. These are ball on ball joints. The round front meets the round rear there. You know what that spells to me? You know what I scream when I see this? I'm sure you had the same reaction. Nunchucks. These are nunchucks. These are bony rods, like hardwood, connected by a flexible tissue, like a nunchuck. Or, you know, which one of the Ninja Turtles uses nunchucks?
Michelangelo.
And why do you know that? And more importantly, why do you admit that you know that? You grew up in the 80s. Yes, nunchucks are interesting weapons because they use angular momentum. They didn't use mass, they use angular momentum. Nunchucks are two segments. There are 45 segments in the nunchucks of these long-necked dinosaurs. 45! So they could do this. They could reach way out, 20, 30, 40 feet, and whack a marauding carnivore. Or they could even do this. And this is a plate, a lithograph from my favorite book as a kid. Called So Long Ago, and here we have an angry mom, let's call it a mom, Brontosaurus. You notice I'm using the word Brontosaurus instead of Apatosaurus? You notice I'm doing this? Do you know why we're doing this? Because Sunday afternoon, we will announce the discovery of the first face bones for Apatosaurus, first face bone. They found lots of Apatosaurus, 1877, back of the head, lots. No face. We have face for Brontosaurus. People say they're the same. Haven't you heard that? They're the same.
Okay.
Like, totally. We have just found the face of Apatosaurus, and it doesn't look like Brontosaurus at all. Turned out to be way different. Yeah, anyway, there's an angry Brontosaurus, and it's theoretically possible for it to wrap the nunchucks around the body of a predator, like a whip. It would work like a whip. It'd have enormous tensile strength. You could crush a predator. You couldn't stab a predator, but you could trip a predator. I'm going to end this talk with the following. Even if you don't like dinosaurs and you're an adult, that's okay. My dad is a retired electrical engineer, public service electric gas in New Jersey. Didn't like dinosaurs. Didn't understand why I like dinosaurs. And I said, but he's a musician. He loves music. I said, Dad, if you go to Washington, D.C., you can go to the National Museum, the dinosaurs, or go to the National Orchestra. Where do more people go? By a factor of 100. Now, I like music. Classical music. I love Wagner. I really do. Willie Nelson. Willie Nelson would sing some Wagner. It would be great. 100 times more people go to Museum of Natural History in D.C. and look at the dinosaurs. Why? Because fossils are jumper cables to your brain. If you don't like them, I don't care. You support the museum outreach in this college, which is very good. You support dinosaurs all over the world. Why? Because they get kids and adults, but especially kids, thinking about science, thinking critically. Remember Buckland? He disproved that the world is young, that this so-called flood producing all the fossils didn't happen. There were many floods local, and that you can piece together the behavior of extinct animals. You could do that all while remaining a good Anglican. Absolutely. He wasn't a radical. Ditto the Reverend Edward Hitchcock. Look him up. Congregationalist. Proved from footprints that what we call dinosaurs were ground-running birds of great size. That's what he called them. And he was right. So you can teach the human mind to look at the evidence and think critically and enjoy a safari back into deep time, where not only are you becoming a better scientist and a better in technology and better in mathematics and better in engineering. Didn't we just talk about engineering here? Did we not? Science? Yes, we did. A little bit of technology, right? And math? Yeah, you can do math. If you want to do STEM, go back in a prehistoric safari and take your kids. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bakker, for being here. We're really appreciating this talk. It's exciting. I know that I was excited watching them. You're going to be here tomorrow.
I will.
We have two sessions tomorrow at our STEM conference. It begins at 9 o'clock. I think registration is 8:30, something like that.
And the first one, which I do at 9, is specifically for kids. I'll be drawing on big poster paper dinosaurs. You identify the dinosaur correctly, you win the poster.
Exciting.
Not to agree not to put it on eBay.
All of those sessions will be over in our CEM building, the Clair E. McKenzie building, which is just neighboring to this one. Right after this, we're going to have a meet and greet reception kind of thing over in our atrium, which is right over to the left or to the right.
Really big shrimp. That's what I'm going.
And we're hoping you can come over and meet Dr. Bakker. We have some books that he's willing to sign. And I wanted to present on behalf of the college a certificate here for you, sir.
Oh, thank you.
And then we got you an ammonite as well. I hope it's not a doorstop or a paperweight, but do whatever you wish with it.
That's a coiled Devonian nautiloid. That's beautiful.
Well, thank you for being here. Right now for a few questions if you'd like, and otherwise we'd like to adjourn over to the atrium of the College Center.
The questions have to be interesting, that is, you've got to combine evolutionary theory with neo-Lamarckism with the critique of postmodernism.
There's still one hand up.
Okay, shoot. Okay, now there is the question is, there is an animal actually that I named, Nanotyrannus, which is much smaller than T-Rex, with a much more delicate muzzle, very sharp, different kind of teeth, and has been proposed by several of my colleagues, well, it's just a baby T-Rex. There's a complete skeleton of Nanotyrannus. I'm about to go to New York and hopefully it will be bought by a museum. This complete skeleton of Nanotyrannus is less than half the size of an adult T-Rex, less than half. The arms of the Nanotyrannus are twice as big as an adult T-Rex, twice as big. The thumb claw is a gigantic hook, and the second finger is strong too, and the whole forearm is bigger than a T-Rex. Now, arms do not shrink as you grow. They don't. There is no way, under the usual laws of ontogeny growing up, that would take a Nanotyrannus and make it into a T-Rex. Unless it had T-Rex, a life history like the alien in the movie Aliens, where it goes through several phyla. So there's this perfect specimen now and several others that show gigantic arms and nano. So it's actually a whole different subfamily of meat eaters. Probably related to something Mongolian. Interesting guy. And their skin. Yeah.
Talk a little bit about the Triceratops.
Oh, we have a Triceratops, one of the best skeletons ever found. Really is great. The wonderful feet. It's a mutter, by the way. You can calculate, speak about engineering, the pounds per square inch on the feet of dinosaurs, if you've got a good foot, Triceratops has gigantic feet, bigger than T-Rex. So in mud, it would do much better. And you would predict, if you're a geologist, it would be found in dark, carbon-rich sediment with fossil plants. In other words, a fossil swamp. By gum, you do. All over North America, you find Triceratops in swamps, and it's got these great big feet. The other really neat thing about our Triceratops in Houston, it's got skin all over. And the skin is not naked. It had things growing out of it, great big bristly-like things. And it is not the only plant eater found with bristly, feathery-like things. There are several others. So dinosaurs, both plant eaters and especially meat eaters, were not naked. They were covered with fuzz and fur and feathers and prickles. Do visit. Visit the Houston Museum. I point you to great seafood places. And the only hot month is August. People are afraid of the Houston eat. Only August. August lasts 6 months.
Any other questions?
Oh, yes. One more.
You're talking about Catsaurus and Brontosaurus and those. You got me thinking about something I had to think about for a while. They're my favorite sauropods, not because they're iconic, but simply because those giant neck vertebrae.
Yes.
They tell you they're actually really odd when you actually look at them. They were doing
this big around. The neck vertebra of a Hepatosaurus, this big around.
I'm wondering if anyone has ever actually come up with any good explanations for what they were doing.
They whacked each other with it. It'd be a weapon. Yes, like giraffes, except much stronger than giraffes, faster than giraffes.
We have another question here.
Here you go, here.
That's your. You want to mouth it to me?
I like you.
Did dinosaurs have a language, or did they speak or talk to each other in their own way?
Yeah, absolutely. If you watch birds today, even so-called primitive birds, like ground birds, including ostriches and rheas, they communicate by gestures and also by infrasound. If you go up to a rhea or a cassowary, you hear these deep, deep, deep sounds produced by pulses of air in their air sacs. Most, not all, but most dinosaurs have some sort of air sacs here and in their snout. The plant-eating dinosaurs were extremely vocal in my book, the new one that just came out. I summarized what a lot of people have been studying since the 1920s. Plant-eating dinosaurs had echo chambers built into their heads that could produce species-specific and age-specific noise. Snorts, very deep, powerful, very low frequency, high energy, and that travels through the ground, through rocks, through trees. So they did talk to each other. Language, it depends how you define language, but they certainly were communicating. And the plant eaters continue.
Another one right here.
What are your thoughts on growth rates throughout the lifespans of most dinosaurs and longevity, lifespans of dinosaurs?
The dinosaurs grew fast. We have lots of data for long necks like Brontosaurus, Apatosaurus, and duckbills, and they grew much faster than elephants. Elephants grow very slowly, as we do. So that breeding weight in a duckbill dinosaur could be achieved in 5, 6, 7 years. Longevity is usually inverse to the rapidity of reaching maturity. I suspect, although the data aren't in, that a big thing like Apatosaurus and Brontosaurus matured more slowly and would have had greater longevity. You might be talking 50, 60 years, elephant ranges. We have growth rates for some little dinosaurs in the Triassic, which was surprisingly slow. So they're all over the map, but their range is more like birds, not like crocodiles or tortoises. Dinosaurs are not reptiles. Don't call them reptiles. Don't call them reptiles again. Remember Edward Hitchcock, the Congregationalist. These are birds.
Another question here.
How had you come up with the conclusion that T-Rex was a hunter as opposed to a scavenger?
Okay, the question is, when you look at an obvious meat eater like T-Rex, was it a hunter or a scavenger? And the answer nearly always is yes. Yes, if you follow lions around, if they find a dead zebra, they eat the dead zebra. Lions are no dopes. Why can't risk being kicked in the face by a live hyena, a live zebra, if you find a dead one? If you follow hyenas around, the living relatives of Billy the hyena, they kill most of their own prey. But if they find one already dead, they eat it. T-Rex is faster than any plant eater of its time. It could catch anything. So if there were an opportunity to bite and kill, it would, I'm sure. And we have several duckbill dinosaurs that escaped the attack of a tyrannosaur. So we had the teeth of a tyrannosaur embedded in the butt, and they got away. So we know they attacked live prey, and that allosaur probably did, in fact, attack that stegosaur and got killed. The evidence we have indicates that meat-eating dinosaurs did attack live prey, and I'm sure they're quite happy to find one already dead, as hyenas and wolves and lions are today. So it's kind of a misleading question, sort of like, you know, did you drive to work or did you bring your lunch? You know, it's... Yes?
On Tyrannosaurus Rex, do the arms actually have a purpose?
Yes, oh, this is really interesting. The guy who named T-Rex was Henry Fairfield Osborne, arguably the greatest museum man of the last century. He put up that Russell Dallasaur. Osborne people found T-Rex. You saw it. First specimen. Tiny arms. Giant jaw. And Professor Osborne was also on the board of the Bronx Zoo. He knew living animals. He said, tiny arms, a meat eater. They're used for stridulation, for touching during courtship. The only way you as a T-Rex could express a delicate thought is with your little fingers. You can stroke your young, you could stroke your mate, you could stroke Uncle Herb when you needed a loan for the mortgage. Part of the proof is the claws are very blunt. They are not hooks. T-Rex claws are very small and weak, and they're not hooks, but they're still there. Whereas Nanotyrannus, it's a much smaller relative, has much bigger arms, with great big meat hooks. So yeah, they had a purpose. It was a social purpose.
One down here.
My son Riley's very interested in the dinosaurs that had feathers, and he wanted to know what the earliest dinosaur had feathers and whether herbivores had feathers.
Okay, let's answer the second part first. For a long time, we didn't think the plant eaters had feathers until our Chinese colleagues found some very primitive little plant eaters, which were covered with quill-like feathers, like kiwi feathers, a couple different kinds. And then we found a little horned dinosaur, Sitakosaur, which had these quills just on the tail. Then we got this giant Triceratops, huge one, which had these holes in the skin to hold feather-like quills. Those are the plant eaters. The meat eaters, every good specimen we've gotten of a Cretaceous meat eaters had some kind of feather. The raptor-like specimens, about 20 now, have feathers like a turkey or chicken, real feathers. The members of the T-Rex family have very, very thin, almost hair-like feathers. So most of the advanced meat eaters had some sort of feathers. The raptors had very wide chicken-like feathers. And the plant eaters had feather-like things too. Not all of them. Duckbills didn't, but a lot of them did. It's a surprise.
Just a couple more here, sir.
Who named Triceratops?
Now that is an interesting question. It was named in the 1890s, way back, 115 years ago, by Professor Marsh from the Yale Museum. He had taken many years of Latin and many years of Greek, and he could make up names that sounded real good. He made up the name Triceratops. Tri means three, cer means horn, ops means face, three horns on your face. It's a nice name. He also named Stegosaurus, which means roofed lizard, because the flat plates on the back kind of look like shingles. He named a lot of them. He named Brontosaurus, thunder lizard, which you've just learned. By the way, don't read this to the press. He's still here. Do we have still a member of the press? Can I edit the tape? No, that'll be announced Sunday about our Apatosaurus. He named Brontosaurus, thunder lizard. This is a good reason for when you get to middle school, take Latin. It's as if you have, I've had 4 years of Latin, two of Greek, on and off Biblical Hebrew. Latin will let you understand French and Spanish and Portuguese and all sorts of other languages and understand dinosaur names, which of course is the best reason to take a language. There are some names of fossils that I cannot translate for you. Is the demography here? Like Stereophalodon, I cannot consider. Name my old professor Romer. Yes?
Now, I do have one question. I know T-Rex is the largest well-known dinosaur, but were there carnivores larger than T-Rex?
Not heavier, but longer. giganotosaurus. They're a bunch of animals related to spinosaurus that have longer faces, but they're not stronger. The head muscles, the jaw muscles are not as strong as T-Rex. All of our data now indicate T-Rex had the strongest bite of any meat eater, by far.
Spinosaurus was the largest.
Spinosaurus had a longer face, but it's much weaker. It's like comparing a Irish setter to a pit bull.
What about Carcharodontosaurus?
Same thing. Carcharodontosaurus has a long face, but not nearly as strong a bite as T-Rex. Carcharodontosaurus and Spinosaurus probably ate mostly fish. They're found with fish. They're found in near shore marine environments.
They live in the same region, right?
Correct. In the Jurassic Park, what, three, Spinosaurus, well, T-Rex takes a dive. Remember, Stegosaurus takes a dive in Fantasia. Watch the fight in Jurassic Park 3 between the T-Rex and the Spinosaurus. Spinosaurus has weak little arms, and supposedly it broke the neck of Triceratops. T-Rex, T-Rex's neck's about that deep. It's all muscle.
That fight was an inaccuracy, though, because T-Rex could have crushed Spinosaurus's neck.
That could scare the Jesus out of it, yes. Look at Poppy Ortiz on the Red Sox. His glare, very left-handed, and bad left-handed. I used to think Poppy Ortiz glared at the pitcher, which is why he hits so many home runs. This is not true. Watch in slow motion, in high-def digital TV, watch Poppy Ortiz. What he does is glare at the ball. He scares the baseball. And it slows down. What a guy.
It's I got a question here in the middle for you, sir.
Yes.
Do you believe that plesiosaurs and pterosaurs and other dinosaurs or like that are actually dinosaurs?
That's a very interesting question. Dinosaurs and pterosaurs, dactyls, very closely related. Very close. You could say that pterodactyls, all pterosaurs, are so close to dinosaurs in the way they're arranged. For instance, pterosaurs have hollow bones, like dinosaurs. Pterosaurs have a simple hinge in their ankle, like dinosaurs. Pterosaurs have pretty big brains. Pterosaurs had some sort of furry covering all over their bodies, like dinosaurs. The sea-going reptiles, like plesiosaurs, long-necked guys with four flippers, are not related at all. They're way off in the family tree of critters, way, 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 way off. As are ichthyosaurs, guys shaped like tuna and dolphins. They're reptiles, and they're not even close to dinosaurs. Interesting guys, but they're not dinosaurs.
Another question here.
Sure.
What is the purpose of feathers?
What's the purpose? Now that's a very interesting question. Feathers are wonderful as lightweight armor. If you have lots of feathers, it's very hard to bite through the feathers, even though they're lightweight. Try this. Go up to a turkey and poke. It's very hard to poke a turkey, seriously. Because the feathers overlap each other to make a lightweight armor. In fact, it was a type of samurai armor which was lacquered feathers together. Feathers also keep you warm and cold nights. It keeps your body heat. And feathers can be colored so you can transmit a message. Like in the breeding season, if you're a dominant male, you can grow bright blue feathers or bright red, or if you're dominant female, the same thing. Most birds have bright colors as adults. The young have camouflage colors. So you can change your color as you grow up, which is really cool. It does all of that thing. And also in a hot climate, it's insulation. The sun's rays tend to bounce off your feathers. Feathers are a great idea. They really are. Probably pound for pound more useful than hair. Don't say that to the Boston Red Sox, but I think.
Go ahead,
sir. Oh, sorry about that. By the way, I did watch the games with the Tigers. I'm a big Tiger fan from way back.
Were there any animals that could have killed single-handedly a T-Rex?
Oh, gosh, happened all the time. Triceratops. Okay. Triceratops is the most dangerous dinosaur ever to evolve. Stegosaurus close second. And it's really, really dangerous. Because it's muscular, it's got very big paws. In the swampy terrain, it would win. You don't follow a wounded triceratops into the swamp, because you'll be skewered. But if you add the outer horny sheath on a triceratops horn, it's this big. You go right through it, a T-Rex, from one side, not the other.
Have any digs ever been conducted underwater instead of just on the surface?
That's done all the time in Florida and elsewhere, usually in fairly young sediment from 26 million Miocene until 10,000. If you visit the Houston Museum, we have a gigantic male mastodon, American mastodon, just huge, and that was discovered in a spring-fed river by diving. And that type of excavation happens all the time. Cool.
Do you have a favorite dinosaur?
I do have a favorite dinosaur, and you should know it. I've said this on TV a whole bunch of times. No one remembers. I have a favorite dinosaur. Here's a hint. Late Jurassic. The biggest, sharpest teeth of any meat eater. The only meat eater with really sharp teeth and a horn on its nose. What? Yes! 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 You win something. I don't know what it is. Extra cookie. Ceratosaurus. It's got huge, sharp teeth, incredibly sharp. T-Rex is called sharp tooth in Land Before Time. It's wrong. Teeth are as sharp as a banana. Banana tooth.
Do you think that the feathers were actually just specialized like scales?
Oh, they absolutely are. If you follow the embryology, the development of bird feathers, in their very, very youngest form before they come out of the socket, so to speak, yeah, they're scales. There's no doubt about it. They're scales.
I'll take one more.
It's got to be profound.
Profound question.
You've got to put in Lutheran theology, the rapture, and Congregationalists.
I've noticed that history changes with increased information.
It does. Well, history doesn't change, our perception of history
changes. Our perception of history changes with increased information. What percentage of the known dinosaurs that have been discovered, and what do you think that makes them out there that we have no knowledge of?
The best estimate would be maybe we have 10% of the genera, the species groups. Like, we know stegosaurs. But stegosaurs are a family, many species. We know maybe 5 different species of stegosaur. I'm sure there are more out there. They're a long-lived group. T-Rex is one species within the Tyrannosaur family, and every year we find more species. So when you're talking about the bigger groups, families, we're doing pretty good. You look at smaller groups, genera and species, 90% are still out there. But there are whole zones of time we haven't sampled.
Sorry, I have to cut us off. Great questions from the audience. And remember, we're going over to the College Center. And you get a book signed from Dr. Bakker, I'm sure he'd be happy to answer other questions.
Really have to keep on abusing this
dude. Yeah. Once again, please join me in thanking him.